Facebook, recording, any other place I need to record. There's so much stuff going on, it's unbelievable. One more camera, hang on.
Tom, you're right. A full-blown IT department.
One second. You know, I got this whole thing going. I feel like a one-man band standing on the side of the corner because it's with coronavirus, you've not seen anyone working with me, right? I don't have anyone working with me anymore. So
you're the videographer of the IT department all in one, huh?
Everything. It's funny, and that's the best part about doing this is I don't have a crew, and the worst part about doing this is I don't have a crew because I rely heavily on my crew.
I can see that.
Yeah, man. So here we go. Crap. One thing. Hold on. All right, that should work. We're good to go. Okay, so down here. All right. Okay. So today, what we've got, a few years ago, I took my boys to Christmas Island, and it was one of the best trips we've ever had, and it was wonderful and made even better because we ran into another family there on the way. I think in the Hawaii airport, we met up with another family, and it was very similar. Dad, two boys, kind of celebrating, I don't know, maybe a high school graduation or something. I was kind of seeing them. I'm like, those guys look like they're going to the same place we're going to. And so we ended up talking, sitting down, became fast friends. The boys got together. I got to be friends with this person, and we ended up fishing all week together, and it was fantastic. That gentleman is Michael Medrano, and he's joining us today because he has something that is really awesome. He's written this book called Stilt Houses of Texas, and I think you were working on this when we were probably back in Christmas Island days, weren't you?
I think I had the idea for it.
Yeah. Well, it looks
like... It was early innings.
Yeah, it looks like it has taken a lot of time, for sure, to write this book. It is a book about the stilt houses. Now, we have stilt houses in Florida, and they are kind of off the homestead area, kind of in Biscayne Bay a little bit. But you have also these stilt houses in Texas. So what was it that made you want to do a book about the stilt houses?
Tom, I have grown up on the Texas coast, and, you know, so for the better part of my upbringing, fishing along the coast of Texas, literally from Galveston all the way to South Texas, you can't help but notice that there's homes literally along the intercoastal. Some of them on spoil islands, some of them literally like the stilt houses in Florida in the water. And no one really ever talks about how those houses got there or who has them. And so it was always intriguing to me that there was these homes, and sort of as a young man, always thought to myself, one of these days I'd love to fish on one of those cabins. And so, you know, it just sort of took 40 years for that to happen, but that's really how it all started.
So you just wanted to fish on one. Would you see, when you're fishing by these things, would you see people like staying there and like enjoying that lifestyle? Like, people are living there.
I Not permanently, usually just sort of over the weekend.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
And so what's the legality here? Like, how did these things start? Could anyone, at one point, could anyone just go plop a stilt house somewhere? I'm sure that's not the case now, but how did it start?
No. Yeah, no, that's actually, they used to call them squatters' shacks.
Okay.
So they literally, back in the day when they were dredging the intracoastal canal through Texas, people literally just set up a cabin or a shack along those spoil banks and set up shop, and no one really said you couldn't do that. And that is actually the genesis for what we now know as the cabin program that's sanctioned by the state.
Hmm.
So, and that didn't really take place until 64 when they passed some legislation in the Texas House to acquire really those properties because it was on state land. But before, if you had the wherewithal to go out there and put some pilings in the ground, you could have a shack on the intercoastal.
Wow. And then along the road there, something probably changed where, I mean, that's kind of like filling a wetland, right? Like you putting piles in the ground. I know in Florida that's
right.
A real no-no. And, you got to get a certain permit, and that's considered like a wetland kind of issue, which is a federal issue, right?
Exactly.
So did that change, and all of a sudden they can't build anymore, or what's the history of that?
Yeah, so there was some legislation that was passed in, I believe it was 1964, essentially acquiring, it was sort of a bundled piece of legislation, but one of the tenets to that piece of legislation was acquiring sort of an eminent domain, but I don't think they paid for the property. But essentially the state going in and claiming that those stilt houses were really built on state property, and so now therefore became part of the state property. And they put those cabins under the General Land Office, which is one of the divisions in Texas that's really charged with leasing state property could be for natural resources or for oyster farming, et cetera. And so now these, call it 410, 408 cabins at the time, became part of the state under the purview of the General Land Office, and then you had to apply for a permit to do anything, make any improvements, or to have a lease. That's how they set it up, and it's still that case today, is you technically have a lease with the state to occupy that cabin. But it's owned by, it's sort of like a hunting lease.
Right.
You can make all the improvements in the world that you want, but they're going to convey to the landowner. In this case, the landowner is the state of Texas.
Yeah. And so that would, I guess at that point, there's no more, so there's kind of a premium on something like this. Like, how would somebody get one at this point? Like, is there a way that you could buy one of these? If you can't build them anymore, or you can't leave, or, I don't know how you would acquire one. It seems.
Yeah. Well, it's not that complex, but it really is and has been a speakeasy. And that's frankly why I got so interested. And it seemed really difficult at the time. No one really knew how to get one. And it's really sort of an obscure division of the General Land Office, but the General Land Office, maybe once a year, maybe once every 2 years, will auction off the right to build a cabin at your expense, again, owned by the state of Texas, but you're building it at your expense, to enter into a lease agreement for, I think today they set them up for 5 years, that's the initial term. And then they can be renewed. But there's not very many of them. Every couple years, they'll have a little plot. Maybe it's a spoil area that they deem, or maybe one gets knocked away, and so they reapportion that into a different area. So they'll auction those off. They're really tough to get. The other way is somehow talk into, coerce, what have you, somebody who's got a permit to transfer it to you.
Now, is that pretty expensive? Like, I would think these things kind of run in the family, you know. It becomes a tradition. I know it does around the homestead area. I told you before, when we were talking before, that I had a client that, you know, kind of ended up with one of these, and it was a blessing and a curse because he had to keep it up, you know, and he didn't want to let it go because it was in the family. But I would imagine that that's kind of the thing here. Like, it's kind of a family tradition probably to go out to these things.
Yeah, I think that that's probably true. It'd be interesting to know what percentage is really like that, but that's the sense that I get. It's so difficult to get one that once you get one, you don't want to let it go, even though there's a lot of maintenance involved, as you could imagine. And none of these are accessible by land. So Everything that you do to that cabin, you have to bring by boat.
Yeah. So what happens in hurricanes?
With respect to what?
Well, I mean, do they make it? I mean, some of these look kind of janky, and you brought everything out here by boat. Let's see, I can actually show what your book looks like here. I'll put this down here. I mean, you can actually bring this stuff out here by boat, so, and it's shallow water, so you're probably very, you can't bring a huge boat there. So you're bringing this out like couple of 2x4s at a time on occasion, I would imagine. So then you have a hurricane or something. I mean, I'm looking on the inside of these, and they're kind of like a treehouse, which is kind of the allure of them. You know, it's like Huck Finn. You know, you go out there and you stay in one of these. But do they do pretty well in the hurricanes?
I would say generally they don't do very well in a hurricane. You know, and knock on wood, mine's all the way down towards South Padre Island. And so if you know the Texas coast, South Padre Island, if you go any further south, you're in Mexico. And these cabins start in Galveston Bay, and they run all the way down to South Padre Island, with the vast majority, I'd probably say 3/4 of these really in South Texas from Corpus Christi on south. So that's the biggest congregation of these cabins. In that body of water, it is ultra shallow. And so again, that's the knocking on wood part. Generally speaking, that area, just in terms of storm surge, has less storm surge than the upper coast, like Galveston, because you have a deeper body of water. And that coupled with the wind is what knocks these things down. They get flooded, and then they don't hold up with all that water inside the cabins.
Right.
But down in far South Texas, they seem to do better because the storms don't have as much tidal surge.
Hmm. Yeah. And what a cool place. So how much time do you spend out at your cabin?
Well, I think about it all the time. but fortunately, I think maybe this weekend I'll have an opportunity to go down there and check it out.
Yeah. Well, what's the weather like now for you?
In Texas, it's not bad. I think it's a little breezy down south for fishing, I think they're forecasting a little bit of rain. So I don't know. Maybe it may be kind of dicey, but you know, we'll manufacture a good time if we have to.
Yeah. So like a weekend at your place kind of looks like you're just gonna fish like all day, and then just kind of come back, cook something, and go to bed, and then get up and fish again. You know, like you can fish these areas. Are they in such a remote area? Like I've fished where you're talking about, where your cabin is, before, like almost down in South Padre, almost in Mexico. And are you getting in such a remote area that you just couldn't spend 2 days in that area? Is that kind of the allure of some of these places?
You know, I think that's true. I mean, the only thing that I would add to the agenda is I'm fortunate enough to have these, but I think most of the cabins are outfitted with lights.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the fishing really doesn't stop when you come back in the evening.
Oh, yeah?
You crank the generators up, turn the lights on, and then it is like, you know, bait mecca, which, you know, translates into fishing mecca. And so it's usually really fun. I mean, I've often had people out there, and we giggle at how much bait fish and fish come up.
So what
I mean,
you,
I've had dolphins.
What about big trout and stuff like that? Like, do they come into the lights?
Absolutely.
And the redfish too, and jack crevalles,
yep.
Probably.
I've never caught a jack. I presume that they would, but I've literally had dolphins come up and just, I mean, you just sit back and just watch the feeding frenzy going on.
And that's super cool. You know, Ernest Hemingway had a stilt house off of Key West, and the stilt portion of the house is still there. It's right off Cottrell Key, and we would pass it every time. And I always thought the same thing, you know, how cool would it have been to go out to one of these stilt houses with, like, Ernest Hemingway? Who knows what went on at that stilt house? But it wasn't like he built his so far out. It was kind of like just a little bit off of Key West and, you know, across Northwest Channel, and there's, like, you can still see where it was. But it wasn't like he built it way out. But I did understand that at some point there were stilt houses in the Marquesas. And that's 25 miles off of Key West. And that seems to make a little more sense to me. Like, you're going to really get away. Like, where Ernest Hemingway built his, it was like 5 miles from Key West. So I don't know, like, why he would want to do that. But, I mean, it was already quiet. Like, Key West was a very small place at that time. And so then he wants to get even further away. I don't know. It's kind of funny when you think back on those days and stuff like that. It's like there's a whole different opinion of crowds and a different opinion of, you know, he's probably thinking, Key West, there's too many people here. You know, it's probably
I just want to get away.
A hundredth of the people that were there before. But the stilt houses have a cool history. Like, you know, you look all over the place, I guess. They have them in Louisiana. You know, I've come across some kind of camps, you know.
Yeah.
But I don't know what that looks like. These look a little more established. Like, looking through your book here. These look
there's definitely some cabins that Tim photographed. We were together the whole time, but that really look more like a beach house or a bay house than they do sort of like a fishing shack. I would say mine is more on the fishing shack side of the equation. But there's some of them. Literally, the cabin next door to mine is a two-story structure that I think can house like 16 people.
Hmm.
I mean, it's a monster. Yeah.
That sounds like one of those cool duck hunting blinds that they have in some places where, you know, they're like three or four stories and they're cooking and, you know, shooting ducks. And usually in Louisiana, it's certainly a place that has more ducks than where I duck hunt, because we try to really be hide and stuff. But some people are able to do it with those three-story places, which, again, is like it becomes like a tradition. So that you can see that in people's families and it stays there. Well, how did you pick Tim Romano as your photographer?
You know, the thought behind the book originally was to team up with fly fishing guides and we just sort of naturally have our coast broken up into thirds, the upper, the middle, and the lower coast. And so the original thought was to team up with fly fishing guides in the upper, middle, lower coast. And the one of the first guides that I had reached out to was a guy named Jared Malone.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think he really guides much anymore, but he was a very well-regarded guide in the Galveston Bay complex. And I had reached out to him, and he was friends with Tim Romano. And when I was sharing with him this idea about the book and what all I was envisioning, he said, you got to reach out to Tim. Tim was from Texas, and he had moved to Colorado and was, you know, obviously very well accomplished in outdoor photography. And so Jared Malone is actually who put me in touch with Tim Romano. And then when I met Tim, it was, you know, it's kind of like meeting you. We hit it off, and I knew that Tim was going to do this project.
Oh, that's cool. And then how much time did it take really for you to work out what the book was going to look like and what you thought, you know, I mean, was it always a coffee table book? Like, that's what I would consider this. This is a big, nice book.
Yeah.
So it was always going to be a coffee table book, and you just envisioned big, you know, landscape photographs like it turned out. Did it turn out like you thought? Like, I know that people launch into these projects and then it's kind of like, man, it took so many twists and turns on the way that it's a completely different project than what it was intended. But what about that for you?
Yeah, good question. I would say, you know, the biggest twist that this book took was that I probably envisioned it to be about, I don't know, 60 pages. and I think it's, I don't know what the last count was. I'm opening my book right now, but it's like
38, I see. Or maybe
it's
more.
238 pages. And you know, Tim and I, this project took 2 years. I hired Julie Savasky out of Austin, who used to be with Pentagram, to design the book. And I'm so glad. I probably thought that I had the wherewithal to do a book like this. And then as I got into it, I realized that this was so overwhelming. and laying out a book is really a whole discipline into itself. And so Julie came on to the project, and she, frankly, is the reason why this book turned out so beautifully. It was sort of bringing I think Tim took close to 20,000 photographs on this project.
Really?
And so culling it down to 200 pages was a lot more difficult than it would sound like.
Yeah, I mean, going from 20,000 photos, how many photos do you think are in here? Because you got some pages that, you know, have six or eight photos, and then you got these giant, big landscape ones. Do you have any idea how many photos are in here?
Yeah, I think the last count, it's several hundred.
Wow. Yeah. Well, he did a really good job. You know, the photography is incredible. And it captures a lot of not just the cabins and stuff like that, but obviously the lifestyle. I mean, there's like bumper stickers and these signs and all this stuff that's kind of around, and then people fishing like around these cabins. It's really, really cool.
You know, Tom, one of the things that was really a surprise, I would say, doing this book. So we, you know, I run a little Maverick HPXT. I don't even make that boat anymore. They make the, you know, the V-holes. So it's not a very big boat. And so I've got Tim Romano on the boat and myself. So there's just the two of us, all his gear. And so we show up to some of these cabins literally unannounced, and we knock on the door, and, you know, I'm sort of just chuckling thinking about it. I mean, he and I knocking on a door, a couple crusty old guys come out like, what the hell do y'all want? And we're sort of pitching this story to them, and then we've got this release, this waiver that they're – they're a model, and that's what Tim's release said. It's basically, you're a model, and you're giving us the right to take a picture of you and to put you in a book. And these guys, you know, after that little introduction, they'd say, you know, it could have been 9 o'clock in the morning. They'd say, right, you guys want a beer? And we'd say, okay, sure. Why
I was
going
to say, man, I mean, looking at some of the pictures here, it looks like you met some real characters.
It was so much. That was the big surprise of the book. I mean, literally friends to this day.
Yeah.
Really funny.
Well, it's easy to make friends when you start drinking beer at 9 o'clock in the morning.
That's true. That's true.
What were some of the biggest challenges? Like, obviously, laying the book out, and you get in kind of over your head. Like, I'm supposed to be writing this book, but I mean, you're not a what do you do for a living? You're not a writer necessarily, are you?
No, just a business guy. But but that was difficult. I think really and Julie did a lot of the work in terms of laying it out, but writing the text, making the book, you know, I think the other goal was to make it fun and as much of a journey going through the book as it was shooting the book. That was kind of the ultimate dream. Obviously, you can do that a little bit, maybe a little easier with a video, but I love the permanence of a book, and it seems like, at least these days, you know, video is such a, not a keepsake, mm-hmm. really. It's a one and done. You watch it, and then you forget where you put it, and to me, I wanted this was such a culmination of a quest that turned into a reality, personally, for me, just having wanted one. And then, you know, I don't know if I ever told you that, I got invited post-college to go duck hunt in one of these.
Oh, yeah?
So sort of a buddy of a buddy had one, in the dead of winter, and I kind of talk about it a little bit in the book. And so we show up, a handful of us, to duck hunt, and it's sort of like duck hunt during the day and then trout fish at night. It just like it. We never slept for a weekend, and it was so much fun. And so I just, you know, having one, and then, you know, it was really difficult to get it, and then to, you know, remodel it and then get it to where it was at least livable. And my wife's gone out there once.
That's the next question.
So to get it to, yeah.
Does your wife like this one?
Yeah, she's been out there once, and that's a big accomplishment. And so, you know, I felt like this book needed to really embody that journey of what it's like to kind of go from coast, the various coasts that we have, and anyway, so that was kind of the spirit behind this, is really make it kind of a journey. And Tim did a great job. Julie, of course, did an awesome job as well. But trying to capture that essence was, frankly, at the end of the day, took a lot longer and was more difficult than I had expected it was going to be.
Wow. Yeah, I can imagine. I mean, did you deal with weather and stuff like that too? Like you got a guy like Tim Romano coming from the Rocky Mountains. Is he still living in the Rockies?
Yeah, but he's a tough guy, and he's salty in his own right. So
yeah.
It was.
Yeah, but still, you know, I mean, you got to go out there in a small boat, and you got, I mean, Texas can have some very serious weather. So
yeah,
you know, did you run into any kind of issues like that? I mean, we run into that stuff all the time. As soon as we decide we're going to film a TV show, it's
yeah,
blowing 200 miles an hour and raining sideways. Did you have any of that kind of issue?
We got sprinkled. We never got a downpour. I think the biggest issue we ran into was just the seas.
Yeah.
And so, you know, breaking it up as we did sort of the upper coast, that wasn't terrible. And we could sort of find a port pretty quickly. When we got into the middle coast, that got a little dicier, because we were kind of venturing far away from where our home base was. And so navigating across the open bay, it, you know, we got wet, put it that way,
yeah.
And it wasn't from rain. And then the South Texas portion, our home base there was Port Mansfield, which is sort of equidistant between Corpus Christi and South Padre. So I ran that little Maverick on one day in particular over 100 miles. And so you know what that's like on a skiff, running 100 miles. And so that was, you know, it was just part of the adventure. We were, we had fun.
Well,
we were a little sore at the end of that trip.
Yeah, well, I'm about to find out what it's like to run a little boat like that, 1,300 miles.
Wow.
We're supposed to have the Skiff Challenge, which is a race around Florida to bring awareness to the water issues. We were supposed to have it a couple of weeks ago, April 1st, right around April 1st. And it was canceled because of the coronavirus. They're trying to reschedule it for September. But it's a race that goes from the Florida, Alabama-Florida line, Florabama line, to around Key West and back up to Jacksonville. So talk about being sore. Because, I mean, I've run a skiff a lot, and you do get very sore. One of the worst stories about that, I guess, would be fishing the Gold Cup tournament out of Isla Mirada, running to Key West and then out to the refueling and then going to the Marquesas and doing that every day. So that's like a, I don't know, that's like a probably 130-mile trip, five days in a row. Man, that, I just decided that I didn't think I was going to need to learn some spots a little closer to the tournament area if I was going to keep doing that. But, yeah, very, very tough. But that, yes, in Texas, you're probably across some of these bays. When we fished the Redfish tournament in Texas, we fished Kima, and Kima was maybe the roughest place I've ever seen. That place, that was, I didn't know how anyone fished there. I mean, literally,
yeah.
Coming from Florida, and we were so spoiled. You know, we get in these shallow draft boats, and we go to the Florida Everglades and the, you know, Flamingo, and it's, you can run banks along the way, and you're fishing in very shallow water. And it's never that rough, so even if it's blowing super hard. But, man, we got there, and, I mean, I remember one guy, he was so scared that he installed two bilge pumps in the cockpit of his Maverick. Two bilge pumps. and just had them like rigged. The wires were just going into the console, you know, and he just wanted to make sure that if he swamped that boat, he was going to keep going, because the Florida guys were scared to death of that Kima area. That was serious water, man. So
well, not only is it deep, but you've got the shipping lane that runs right through the middle of Kima. So you get those big ships that come through, and boy, they push a wake that will literally capsize a boat.
Yeah, I can believe it. We thought we were going to capsize just leaving. I can't even remember where on that shoreline the tournament was being held, but there was a tight channel that went out, and man, as soon as you got out to the markers, the wind hit you sideways, and the seas, you know, were huge. As soon as you got out of the lee right there, it was serious, and people were trying to do that in these little boats, and it was borderline very, very scary. Do you fish that area, Kima?
I don't much. I have, but I don't really anymore, and I sort of wait to get down to South Texas. Yeah. That's sort of my favorite place to fish.
Well, that was a lot different. South Texas was much more like our Florida fishing than the Kima fishing. We felt way more Port Aransas area. We fished down there, and it was beautiful. I mean, we were seeing tailing fish all over the place. You could actually see into the water, and we felt much, much more comfortable there than we did in Kima. I didn't know what to do in Kima. That was one of the weirdest places to fish, and I just had so much respect for those guys that fish there every year, every day, because I mean, they were doing things that I had never seen before, like just looking out over the water and finding fish, because they would see where they were feeding, and the oil from the other fish would come up to the surface. And I mean, I know that you do that in some places, and that's pretty common, but the water here, when I say it was the color of the road, like it was the color of asphalt. It was so gray, you could see less than an eighth of an inch into the water. And these guys are able to find fish and catch them there. And I mean, most of the Florida guys were at a loss, just completely lost, had no idea what to do. And those guys they could do it. It's amazing.
Yeah, it is. And what's even more amazing is, you know, the petrochemical facilities that we have in the Galveston Bay complex, and it is such a prolific fishery. You know, the oysters that are there. I mean, the times that I do fish, and I've got a lot of buddies that fish in that body of water, and they just consistently catch fish. It's really a testament to the resource that we have here in Texas. It's amazing.
When you say petrochemical, you reference that. What do you mean? Like you're fishing around that kind of stuff?
You know, there's a couple pictures in the book of cabins with the background.
Yeah, I saw that.
Like that kind of petrochemical.
Yeah, and you see that in Louisiana a little bit too. And it's just the fishing is just so good that you can plop one of these giant chemical plants right in the middle of it, and it's still good.
Yeah.
It's crazy. But I did see that. What about the do you have the small little oil? I guess it's a well of some sort, a natural gas well or an oil well. We fish around these things in Louisiana all the time, and you see
mm-hmm.
those. Is that something that you're fishing around?
Well, definitely in that Kima, Galveston. I would say that's really more East Bay, in the Galveston Bay complex. And you're right. I mean, those things can turn into, you know, sort of a little fish mecca as well.
Yeah, I mean anything. And then, you know, what we found is that there was all sorts of stuff around there. Like, I don't know if the people that were working on the boat that usually goes out there, their tractor broke or something. They just dumped it in the water, and there was all kinds of stuff to hit. We hit everything. It was a nightmare. First time I went to Louisiana, I had no idea what I was doing, and then I really got scared because we hit a number of things that weren't supposed to.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you know, the chart says it's clean, so who knows what it was, you know, but it was pretty solid, and we managed to not rip the motor off the back of the boat, but, I mean, within the first 15 minutes, we had hit something really hard, which was probably the best time to hit it, because that really slowed us down. Like, we were like, okay, hold on, we don't know what we're doing, and if you go up this little cut that looks exactly like this little cut, this one has a whole bunch of pipelines and stuff in it, so don't do that. So you really, really had to be super careful. But that's cool, man. This is a really great book. I would certainly encourage anybody that is looking for a coffee table book or whatever to check this one out, because the photography in this is really good, and it really does tell. You guys did a good, really good job all the way when it's laid out, to the photography, to just how kind of it moves from, you know, down the coast in a logical kind of way that I'm not even that familiar with Texas, but I could kind of follow it in the maps. It's really cool. It's really a nicely done thing that makes me realize I need to get and fish Texas more often, because the amount of diversity in the fishing and the landscape and the stuff that you're showing in here, like what we're talking about, like between Kima and Port Aransas, that's quite a different.
It really is.
Yeah, but I loved it. I got to get over there and fish with you. We were planning on doing a little something for this book, and that's
I know.
When that hurricane hit, right? What hurricane was that? That was one that hit so bad.
That wasn't Harvey. The one before Harvey, I believe.
Yeah, but I was disappointed that we couldn't make that happen. So we met at Christmas Island, and have you done any more trips like that since then?
Well, I thought about a lot more trips like that. I've done some Bahama fishing, and then took another big trip. It was without the boys to the Seychelles.
Oh, nice.
But you know, I think about that Christmas Island trip. That fishery was something else. And
it's really one of my favorite trips ever. And I don't know about you, but one of the things that I liked about Christmas Island so much, and you may have seen this in the Seychelles too, I've never been there, but it was just such a lack of worldly influence on that island. Like, it was like, literally, I mean, it's one thing if you fly a long way and you get someplace and everybody's wearing, like, NBA jerseys and there's McDonald's and there's, you know, like a real American influence. And when we got to Christmas Island, it was not like that. I mean, that was like, you felt like you were out in the middle of nowhere, and you are.
You are in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, but that was one of my favorite things about that. Like, it was just super cool.
And the people were so welcoming too. Wasn't that just?
Yeah, I could easily go back to Christmas Island. I've been there twice. That was the second time, and I you know, and it was such an important trip for me, because my oldest son was graduating high school, and that's what we were celebrating. I can't remember. Your boys are just a little bit older than mine. So what were you guys doing?
No, it was our middle child that was graduating, and so we drug the older one along with him. I don't know if you recall, but Ben is, at the time, he certainly was the least fishy of the two boys.
Yeah.
And so he really felt like it was a graduation present for his older brother.
Yeah, but as I remember, he did quite well and came
he
around
did.
Doing really well. Yeah, it was funny how similar the trips were, because, you know, I was doing a celebration for my oldest son. You were doing a celebration for your youngest son. My younger son kind of, I mean, I just told my older son, like, Turner, we really need to bring Hayden. Like, this is a once-in-a-lifetime kind of thing, maybe, and let's ask him. And he's like, yeah, of course, let's go. And so we take the two boys, and it was fantastic because we just had so much good time together. But I just never forget, like, just checking you guys out in the airport. I'm like, I bet they're going where we are. And then, you know, the boys are about the same age, and just looked cool. It was
fun.
Sweet deal.
Yeah, and we were roommates too, sort of bunkhouse mates.
I know. And then it worked out nicely too, because there was a whole other group of people that we, you know, had we not gotten together, we would have pretty much just been outsiders to that other group. Like, I don't know, the camp could probably hold like what, 20, and 16 of them were came together. So it just worked out perfect. It was great. We need to do another trip like that.
I agree. And I don't know if you remember this other, there were sort of like three groups in the airport in Hawaii that we were all kind of looking at each other. I wonder if this guy and these are going to go to the same place. And it looked like a husband wife team, a real big guy. And I remember sort of talking it up with him, and he was checking out his fly box, and all he had really brought were triggerfish flies. You remember this?
No, yeah. Yes, I do.
And I hadn't really put that on my radar as the quarry that we would be going after. But he started basically telling me that that's all he would go after were triggerfish. And that ended up becoming so fun to go after when we were there.
Yeah, that was great. And that's what was – I think that we even talked about that shortly after. You're like, oh, I just met this guy, and all he wants to do is triggerfish. And so I had been to Christmas Island almost 20 years before, and we didn't throw at a triggerfish one time. We didn't throw at a milkfish one time. We didn't throw at any – it was not something that they fished for at that time. And so to go back and have this change so much that that's like the number one target was interesting. So, I mean, when I went there the first time, I was like, what's that? That looks cool. Let's fish for that. And the guides are like, no, we go bonefish, man, up here. You know, and we keep going. And I'm like, I don't know. It seems pretty cool. Like, you should probably try to catch one of these triggerfish. But we never did. And that added a lot to that trip. Because you could catch bonefish, you could have a second rod, the guide would be carrying the second rod for you, and then you'd start fishing for these triggerfish. But there'd only be like, you know, four or five different shots, and then right back to the bonefish, and then you'd just walk, and you could catch bonefish all the way down until you saw more triggerfish, and then you could move to that. And then the trevally. Christmas Island had such a good mix, and you ended up with the biggest fish of the whole trip.
Yeah,
as I remember,
GT.
Nice giant trevally. I saw maybe one really good one there, but I didn't have any luck with it. Is that what you were fishing for in Cosmoleto or Seychelles?
Yeah, that's where we went in the Seychelles was Cosmoleto, and that is that's sort of like target number one are the GTs. We kind of had a marginal trip if I were to grade it. Lots on the milks and bones and a few of the, which was really fun, the Indo-Pacific permits.
Yes.
What a cool fish that is. But the GTs, for some reason, were out of the lagoon. And they claimed that they typically feed on these red crabs. I don't know if you remember all those red crabs in Christmas Island.
Well, I do. And we saw some red crabs when we were there together, but on the trip before, when I went 20 years before, they were everywhere. I mean, and I had told my boys about them. I'm like, when we get there, you won't believe what I thought that just happened all the time, but apparently I was there during the walk. Like, there's a certain time of the year where those crabs walk, and they were on the road so thick that you couldn't see the road. And I remember taking a run, and I would run, and they would get out of the way just before my foot struck down, because I was like, oh, I can't run on the road. But I started walking, and they would get out of the way just in time for your foot. And so I started walking a little faster and a little faster and a little faster. Turns out that you could run, and it just looked like you were just going to land on a bunch of crabs, but they would move out of the way just enough. And it was one of the coolest and weirdest and spookiest runs I've ever had. But I told the boys about it. I was like, you won't believe these crabs. And then we didn't see very many. No, they were like, oh, no, that's only one time a year. So I had hit it perfect the first time.
Well, I think that's what those GTs like to eat. And in Cosmoleto, when we were there, those red crabs, apparently they're very prolific, had gotten blown out of the lagoon. And so the GTs went outside the lagoon and were feeding on the red crabs that were out at sea.
Well, that's an amazing – I mean, I could see how that could happen, because – that's an amazing amount of biomass, you know, moving out. Those fish have to eat it, you know. I would imagine if that's what's going on. I've never heard that before, but I would like to say I fish in the South Pacific much more than I do. I've been there twice, so my experience is very limited. But I have talked to some other people that went to the Seychelles. They had a really, really good trip. Do you have any other trips that you think about or you want to do?
You know, there's I've never been peacock bass fishing, and that just seems, especially on a fly rod, like such a cool fish to catch. I'd like to do that, and I've never been to Alaska.
Yeah. Well, both of those are good. First of all, you can come to Florida and do the peacock bass fishing. You don't have to go around the world. They have some really amazing peacock bass fishing in Florida, and all these other exotics. I have this one fish on my list that has been on my list for a long time because I had one in college, and I've said this. Everybody that listens to this podcast is probably really tired of this story, but I had this fish called a royal knife fish or a clown knife fish. And it's this very strange-looking fish that has a fin on the bottom that kind of undulates. It's not like doesn't have like a tail like a bone fish. It's got like a more of like an eel look to it. And and somehow these have gotten into this chain of lakes, Lake Ida, in Florida, and they're getting really big, like really big. I'd say that the biggest one in the world might be 15 pounds, and they're catching them 12 and 13 probably, or 11 and 10. I don't know. They look huge. So I've always wanted to catch one of those since the first time that I saw somebody was catching them, because I was like, I had that fish in an aquarium for years. So that would be something fun to do that. But I've wanted to go to the Amazon and do that. Then the Arapaima is another fish that I thought would be cool. But the Alaska trip, that's one I'd love to take the boys or even my daughter on, because it just that's one like Christmas Island. I mean, if you go up there during the right week, everybody catches fish, and there's so many different things. Like if you're a really good fisherman and you're tired of catching salmon, you can go and fish for the rainbows, and they can be really hard to catch. And you know, that's like the guy that went to Christmas Island and all he wanted to do was fish for trigger fish. Like he had already caught enough bonefish, he had already caught enough trevally. Now he was just dialed in on these. So you'll get people that'll go up to Alaska and they'll only be interested in the rainbows. But you know, somebody that has a little bit less experience will catch chum salmon all day long, like as many as you want, and there's nothing wrong with them. They're amazing. They're so fun to fish. They're actually a little bit too easy to catch for some people. They're just like, yeah, okay, now move on to the next thing, you know.
Right.
But that's what I love about Alaska, is you could take a family up there where everyone has different interests, different skill levels, different attention spans, and everybody's going to find something they like to fish for. And, you know, I loved it. Like, if you're into really big fish, then you got king salmon. If you're into, you know, the smaller fish, then you can fish for the grayling. Or you could fish for the rainbows, or you could just do it in so many different ways. I don't know. That'd be a great trip, really great trip, Alaska. But the Arapaima, I had a guy on the podcast recently, and he was catching those Arapaima. That sounded pretty awesome, but it didn't sound like he caught a lot. That's what I like.
Yeah, I think they're pretty hard, aren't they?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think you catch a few a day, maybe. I don't know. But that's the thing I liked about Christmas Island, is you can catch a lot of fish there. And there were ways that if you wanted to, if you were like, you know, you got tired of catching the mid-sized bonefish, you could tell the guide, like, I only want to try for big ones this afternoon. And you weren't going to catch as many, but you might catch some bigger ones. But somebody was just after numbers, man. You could just rack them up.
I know, all day long.
I had that fly, the green worm. You remember the green
worm? Yeah, I remember that. I think I may still have a couple of your yellow and orange worm.
Yeah, well, I had this fly that was the green worm, and it was made out of, off a skirt, or the material that you would make a skirt for a marlin lure. And it was just this green plastic with sparkles in it. And I had just cut some, like a pololo worm, like a little bitty French fry, and I had lashed that on the hook, no hackle, nothing but lead eyes and this strip. And I showed it to the guide, and I had green ones, and I had red ones, and anyway.
You had yellow and orange ones.
Yellow and orange ones, yeah.
Yeah.
And I didn't tie that many because I didn't think they would work that great. I showed it to the guide day one, and he was like, no, I don't. He picked that one. He looked in the box, and that's the first one he said no to. And then he found like a more conventional one. So I snuck it on there. He's like, what did you catch that on? Green worm. He's like, really? And he said, let me see. And he wanted to take the hook out of the fish himself. And he looks over there, and he's like, he just looks at the fly like, the green worm, the green worm. He just kept saying, the green worm. And then I proceeded to throw that in front of, I think, every fish that saw it ate it. And I just gave him all the rest of them. And he was like, the green worm. He just went home dumbfounded. The green worm.
I think all of us were dumbfounded, too. You were kind enough to give us a few.
Well, I was happy that that one worked because it is the easiest fly in the world to tie. And, you know, I'm only a marginal fly tier, so I need easy flies to tie. If they get real, you know, crab patterns and crazy things, I can tie them, but I don't like to. I can turn out a lot of green worms, dozens, hundreds
of
dozens.
Now, I tell you what we need to do is we need to figure out the fly for our sheep's head, which is essentially like the trigger fish that we were catching, right? And I think they bite really the same way. At least the few trigger fish that I've caught, it's a very similar bite to a trigger fish.
When you're fishing for the trigger or the sheep's head, are they super spooky?
Very, very.
They're super spooky in Flamingo and Florida too, and a lot of people are starting to fish for those much more seriously, like going after them as a target. And the flies are, and you know, when that starts happening, the flies start to get better and better and better, just like with permit fishing or anything else, where now if it becomes a thing, then people will start, you know, putting time and effort into making the flies better or whatever. But I always caught them on live sand fleas, like when I was bait fish for them. And I know that they eat those things really good. So
yeah.
That'd be where I would start is tie a fly that looks like a sand flea, which, I don't know, that seems tough a little bit. I had to put a good fly tire like Drew Ciccone on it and let him tie a sand flea pattern for us. But, yeah, how do you fish for them now? Do you throw way out in front of them and then just wait for them to find it, or are you trying to cast at them?
Yeah, a little of both. We sort of seem to find, at least in the real skinny water, the little ones are very skittish. Some of these bigger ones kind of will hunker down a little bit longer, but they're very boat skittish.
Yeah.
You get the boat too close and they're gone.
Yeah, they have been. I mean, they're real tough. We don't catch a lot of them. The only time I've ever caught a lot of them was when I was fishing with bait and fishing in water that was deep enough that they couldn't see us. And and you could catch a lot of them around pilings and stuff like that. But you know, the sheephead does eat well. I don't know if you've ever eaten one. They're kind of hard to clean. They got a lot of bones in them, but they do eat.
Yeah.
They do eat very well. So, but more people are trying to catch them.
Yeah.
So do you fish with, like, crab patterns, or what do you – because they seem like they would be something that would eat something with a shell on it if you just look at their mouth structure.
Yeah, and it's really the smaller the better, I've found. I mean, I wouldn't say that I'm a prolific sheep's head catcher, but but at least the looks that I've gotten, they've tended to be a little bit smaller offering than a large shrimp pattern or a large crab.
Yeah, well – I don't know. You got to get it in the water. That's a big part of fishing for a spooky fish is they might eat stuff that's a little bit bigger, like a permit. You know, maybe a larger fly would work well, but you got to actually cast it over there and you got to get it in the water and do that all without spooking them. So, you know, maybe a smaller fly helps with that too. You can cast a lot closer to them, and if you can cast closer to them, then you're more likely to intercept them on their path. But yeah, I'd like to do that. Like to come over there to Texas. I got some other friends in Texas that I'd like to see too. It's funny because my friend he used to live a lot closer to us, and then he is the athletic director at SMU. And it was funny because when I met you, you actually reminded me a lot of my friend, and I was like, "Huh, that's weird." And
that's funny.
And then you were both from Texas, so that's interesting. So what's on the horizon for you? You got trips planned, you got books, you're gonna just go back to work. What are you doing?
Yeah, no, I'm running a company today called Score Vision. Which is a really, really cool company. It's headquartered in Omaha, Nebraska. you know, I live in Houston, Texas. Mm-hmm. So, and we have an office in Houston, but they, ScoreVision is a software company that's developed scoring and some video capture technology used primarily by high schools and colleges to elevate their game time production, et cetera. And so I've been involved with ScoreVision for a little over 2 years now. And so it's been really such a fun venture, and the business is doing really, really well. And we're looking forward to school getting back to a new normal sometime soon. So hopefully everybody, you know, is in a position to start schools back up in the fall. I know at least the schools in Texas are talking about it, but well, you know, various parts of the country are a little different.
I've already heard that some California schools have already just said that they're not going back, which
yeah.
I think is very early. Like how could you possibly know this early that you're not going to open in the fall? It just
yeah.
seems really early.
I agree. I think we need to wait and see. I just hope that, you know, we all don't just put our hopes on some sort of elusive vaccine as the criteria with which we look at the world as normal again, because I don't know if that's the proper reality.
Yeah, well, it seems like it's a long way down the road. I don't know. I kind of thought that the whole purpose of the lockdown was to not overwhelm the hospitals, and
yeah.
that people were going to get sick with this, you know, probably, but we don't want it all to happen at once. You know,
yeah.
so let's, you know, flatten the curve or whatever. But I don't know. I hope everybody goes back to school. I hope everybody has a football season this fall and other sports. As far as ScoreVision goes, does that allow like high schools or colleges to televise their games or stream their games? Is that what kind of the technology that you're working on?
It's yes is the short answer to that. We actually just acquired a business, closed on it on March 31st. It was a company based in Sacramento, California called FanTag. And these guys had developed some video capture technology, and it enables somebody to do this OTT type streaming,
yeah.
over the top type streaming. But it's all through an app. And you can input just traditional cameras into the system. But we acquired them really to bring video capture in terms of being able to sling out moments, highlights, and then ultimately also be able to provide live stream of athletic games. And I guess hopefully looking back, it may have been a very timely acquisition given what's going on. But the premise behind what we do is really to enable schools to do a lot more with little budgets. And
yeah.
so it's just been fun to see how these high schools and colleges, but really, you know, people who couldn't afford to do something cool like that, be able to do that with our software.
Right. That's I'm working with something kind of similar as we do this, and I keep looking down because I'm actually switching these cameras. I've got a bunch of different cameras as well as the Zoom thing that we're doing, and then I can switch all the cameras right here. And I was telling my son, I'm like, what I have right here doesn't cost very much, but it would have been a production truck parked in the driveway a couple of years ago worth millions
yeah.
of dollars, right? And now that technology is coming down so much, and I can live stream, like right now, this is going out to YouTube and Facebook Live. We tried to do the Instagram Live.
Instagram.
Which I think, do you think that the people that you work with as far as all this video capture technology, you're going to think that it's funny that we couldn't get this Zoom call going?
We weren't supposed to tell anybody. Exactly.
Well, I mean, sometimes it works really well, but I do believe 100% that you're in the right space, because I feel like, you know, even just in this quarantine, I mean, Zoom calls, now that's a part of the vernacular. Like, people are like, yeah, I do Zoom calls every single day, or we're doing a video conference or whatever. I think the technology is going to rapidly advance in all of this, to where the audio is going to get far better, the video is going to get far better. I think the cameras that come in a computer, just like you see the cameras on cell phones, have gotten better. But that's for people wanting to take pictures and stuff like that. I think you're going to see a lot of technology, you know, not just with companies like you, but with the big guys like Apple and the Samsungs and the people that make the phones. They're going to start making the front-facing camera as good as the back-facing camera, so people
right.
can do more video conferencing and things like that. And the next thing you know, it's going to be like you have somebody sitting next to you. I mean, we're going to look back at these days kind of like...
I know.
You remember when we had those clunky video conference things like a Zoom and just kind of, you know, maybe Zoom can keep up. I hope you can, Zoom, but, usually the leaders get overtaken. But I do think that there's going to be a tremendous amount of technology in this space. You guys are probably already working on it and know way more what's coming up than I do, but it is pretty exciting.
No, it's fun. Yeah, it's fun. It's fun to be working with kids and really show them how they can do what they have always wanted to do but never really could. And so that's been great. I tell you, ever more today than maybe even before, you know, just being out on the water and smelling the salt air is just, oh my gosh, what a place to be. And for a while, the place that I like to fish, like I've mentioned, is South Texas. And I normally call home base Port Mansfield, and they've had that port, that marina, completely shut down. You couldn't even launch or take a boat out of the water if it was already in the water. For the better part of a month and a half. And so, you know, I don't know. Being outdoors is still a magical place, and I think this makes it even more so.
Yeah, I think I've certainly seen that more people are pushing towards the outdoors. I mean, you have a lot of businesses right now that are certainly struggling, and you have a lot of businesses that are doing the best they've ever done. And some of that is fishing tackle, like cast nets. I know that the cast net Barracuda has sold out of cast nets, best month they ever had.
Wow.
And then on the other hand, you have somebody that's not selling much of anything, but it's like people want to get back out there so bad, and it's the perfect social distancing. I mean, that's what fishing is all about. I don't want to fish next
exactly.
to anyone. And I don't need 6 feet. I need 6 miles.
exactly.
Between me and the next person, but I don't know. I hope that people will continue to push towards the outdoors when we get back to normal. And I think we are getting back to normal. Are you seeing in Texas like that Port Mansfield that people can now go and get their boats out of the water? Because I would imagine you have a tremendous amount of growth on the bottom of your boat after 50 days of quarantine.
They opened it back up. You know, I don't know if this is a proper generalization, but it sort of seems like the people of Texas don't really like to be sequestered in the teepee. You know what I mean?
They do.
Yeah, like you tell sort of generally speaking, the Texans that they can't do something and they want to do what you just said you can't do. So. I think the troops are definitely restless here, and it's really evidenced by just sort of walking around and I don't know. I think we can do it smart, but hopefully it's sooner rather than later.
Yeah, I hope so, man. I really do. But anyway, I know you're a busy guy, so I want to thank you for coming on the show today and showing us this awesome book. I've got the book right here. Let me show it to everybody one more time with my fancy switching camera here on the thing. It's called Stilt Houses of Texas, Michael Medrano and Tim Romano. It's a beautiful book, so you should check that out for sure. And that's going to be it for today. Michael, how would people get in touch with you? How would they see your book? How could they buy your book? How do they do that?
Yeah, we have a website for the book, stilthouses.com. You can also find the book on Amazon, but the website talks more about the book, and you can buy it there or you can buy it on amazon.com.
Okay. And what about, you got any social media or anything like that?
Yeah, Stilt Houses on Instagram, and then We have a contact page on that website as well. Happy to interact. In fact, I've had a couple calls in the last few months on from people wanting to figure out how to get a cabin. So I'm happy to be a how-to guide as well.
You can tell them how to get a cabin, but not the one next to you, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, that one's not for sale. But anyway, all right, man. Well, it's awesome catching up with you. I hope you'll tell your boys hi. I know we talked just briefly before. One of them's getting married. That's really cool. And we're just moving into this next season of life. So as we do that and somebody gets married or I get Turner, he's about to graduate college. Hayden is going to be a sophomore in college. So I don't know. We got some kind of, and my daughter's going to graduate from high school next year. So there's a lot of possible celebrations. We might be able to go peacock bass fishing or Alaska. That sounds awesome.
Hey, you're welcome anytime to just come catch a trout or a redfish, or maybe we can try to spice it up and catch a Texas tarpon.
Okay. What's a Texas tarpon? A carp?
A real tarpon, but caught in Texas.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I'd like to catch a Texas tarpon. I've never caught a tarpon in Texas, but I'd be happy to. I also one day want to go to that area that I was warned about so much that I just stayed away, that has the all the rock.
Baffin Bay.
Baffin Bay, that's it. Yeah, I want to go there sometime. We almost went there in the redfish tournaments, but I understand that that's a very tricky place to navigate if you don't know what you're doing, so I'd love to see that sometime. And I'd also love to see your cabin, man. That'd be cool.
Let's do it.
Okay. Sounds awesome. Okay. So go follow, Michael Stilt House on Instagram and check out his book and you will be super happy. All right. Thanks, man. Tell your family I said hi and we'll talk to you soon.
All right. Likewise.
All right.
See you, Tom.
See you.
Bye-bye.
Okay. So I only had one camera go out. Okay, good. You're gone. Do this. All right, that was cool to catch up with Michael Medrano. Wrote that cool book. As always, this podcast is brought to you by Waypoint TV. You can go and find all of your best outdoor content on Waypoint TV. Specifically, you can go to Samsung Plus, and you can go to these Plus channels like Samsung Plus itself, Zumo, Tubi, Stir, and many others. Also, Pluto. Running marathons on Saturdays and Sundays for Saltwater Experience and Into the Blue on Pluto TV. That's an absolutely free channel, so you can go there and watch that. Brought to you also by Hook. Go to hookgear.com. Use the code SE30 for a 30% site-wide discount. You can get anything you want. Get some shoes. They got awesome shoes. I love the Makos. That's my favorite right now. I also like the waterproof boots for throwing the cast net. Those are really nice. And then they have amazing rain gear. And getting that at 30% off is really good. So you can do that. Brought to you by Manscaped. Manscaped is has the best grooming equipment for all the men in your life. I just bought my son a couple of things there. They got a new thing coming out. It's a weed whacker. You stick it up your nose and you'll have no more problems with nose hair anymore. So that thing is coming out and it's going to be really good. And we're brought to you by Kettle and Fire. If you are on a keto, paleo, or Whole30 diet, this stuff is great for that. It's great for digestive health. You can just sip it like a cup of coffee, or you can drink it or cook with it or whatever. Bone broth can be a real pain to cook yourself. It takes about 20 hours. It stinks up your whole house. I've done it many times. And while I like bone broth, sometimes I don't like it enough to stink up my whole house. So you can get Kettle and Fire bone broth shipped right to your house. Use the code Waypoint at kettleandfire.com. You can get a discount on that as well. Okay, we're also brought to you by Barracuda Tackle. Barracuda Tackle, the makers of the finest cast nets. They also have this really awesome D-hooker. It's the best D-hooker, in my opinion. It's long, and you don't get bit by any sharks or barracudas or kingfish or whatever, and it actually takes the hook out for you. It's made out of really heavy-duty material, so one can last you a whole season or maybe more, depending on how much you fish. So anyway, the Barracuda tackle, they're putting that out. They're putting this magnet out where you can put a magnet on your boat. You can keep all of your hooks and jigs and everything like that. And they're coming up with this cool little boat wrench that we're actually going to have some giveaways on this kind of stuff coming up soon. Not to mention that they make the best cast nets in the world. So Barracuda Tackle, they are a sponsor of this show. We're glad to have them. So if you could support them, that would be fantastic. Okay, that's it for today. We will see you next week.